Thanks for having me over here, guys, tonight to talk to you about a very historic site in Cork, St. Joseph's Cemetery. I suppose the first question I should ask you is, do you all know where St. Joseph's Cemetery is? You do. It's on Torrey Top Road. People say Torrey Top Road, Balfihan, but it's actually Torrey Top Road, Turner's Cross. It's actually in Turner's Cross Parish. That side of the road where the cemetery is the edge of Turner's Cross Parish. So it's within the Turner's Cross Parish boundary. So that's where we're talking about. We're talking about the place that was founded by Father Matthew, and we'll come to Father Matthew in a few minutes. The talk tonight consists of a look at the kind of history of the cemetery and how it developed and changed hands over the decades. And then we'll step inside and we look at some of the headstones and some of the people. And we're only really scratching the surface this evening. You know, there's a huge volume of history in there. I mean, I don't even talk about the Fenian stuff. I mean, we know 1867 and 2017, this is the 150th anniversary of the Fenian uprising this year. And St. Joseph's has by far and away the most Fenian burials in Cork. They were calculating, well, they counted them actually around the turn of the century in terms of the 1900 into the 20th century. They calculated that there were something like around 200 Fenian burials in St. Joseph's. Compare that to the next cemetery or graveyard. The next highest number is St. Finbar's Cemetery in Glasheen, and that had only something like 16. So there's a huge difference. So this is where all the Fenians were buried, which I won't even talk about tonight because there's a whole talk on that on itself. So St. Joseph's Cemetery began its life not as a cemetery, not even as botanic gardens, but as a kind of a series of allotments where people would come out from the city, escaping the grime of the city in the 18th and 19th century, and came out here. They had all these plots that they would use for their own purposes, cultivating plants or shrubs or maybe fruit and veg and stuff like that, or just to escape the grime of the city, come out, and some classes used to come out and be held out here in the open air. And it was held in a place called, you see the word? Lilliput. Lilliput was the name of the area, not specifically St. Joseph's Cemetery itself, but the area between Friars Walk, which is this road here, and what's now the Curra Road, which is this road. This would be the Evergreen Road coming out, turning where the church is today, out the Curra Road. So the area between those two is known as Lilliput. It's a term we know, of course, from Gulliver's Travels and Jonathan Swift. Did he see that name here? He knew Cork, of course. I don't know how far back the name goes. That's the earliest reference I can find to it. Map-wise, it's the 1811 County Grand Jury map, or City Grand Jury map, sorry. And that shows it there quite plainly. But Lilliput, around this period, actually around 1811, part of it was taken over by the Royal Cork Institution. And they started botanic gardens, or botanical gardens, out in Lilliput. And again, they were cultivating plants and planting trees and shrubs, and they were using all the plants they were growing for their classes that they were holding in the city, both in the South Mall and later in where the Crawford Art Gallery is today. It didn't last that long, the botanic gardens. It only lasted up until around 1828. At that stage, a government grant was withdrawn and the gardens had to shut down. They couldn't afford to keep it open. So the landlord, when they were only leasing it, put it up for sale or for lease. And this advertisement appeared in the Cork Constitution newspaper in 1829, January 20th, you can see there. And it shows botanical gardens to be let. And it goes down what's available for people if they wanted to take it over. And one man who saw this ad, or heard about it, was of course the man I mentioned previously, Father Matthew. And he was looking for a place to start a cemetery. So he leased 5.5 acres of the ground out here, and he opened a cemetery in February of 1830. And from that day, right up until the present day, there have been burials in St. Joseph's Cemetery. Now, he got into a bit of strife over a few years later because the man here, Reverend Richard Crowley, who was the landlord, or at least one of them, took him to court because he claimed that Father Matthew never said he was going to start burying people, never said he was going to actually start the cemetery there. But that was thrown out, and eventually that was all sorted. So from 1830, February 1830, burials have been taking place in St. Joseph's Cemetery. It's the oldest public cemetery we have in the city. Now, I have to make a distinction here between cemeteries and graveyards. Cemeteries are kind of areas of ground that are open specifically for burials. A graveyard would be basically the ground attached to a church. A cemetery wouldn't necessarily have a church. So if you think of it like St. Mary's Cathedral, the graveyard there stretches back nearly well over 1,000 years. So St. Joseph's Cemetery doesn't touch it in terms of age, but in terms of being the first cemetery we have in Cork City, this is it, or the oldest one. St. Mary's Cemetery in Glasheen would have come about in around 1868-69, so almost 40 years later. So Father Matthew begins his cemetery here, and this just gives you an idea of the kind of area that he had. These are two ordnance survey maps from 1841 and 1900, and this is the original cemetery here. This is the gate that we looked at previously on Torneytop Road, or Torneytop Lane as it was called then, which used to come up from the Cork Road, dogleg across by where Connolly Road is today, and then come out by the Marion Pharmacy. Do you know the Marion Pharmacy on Friars Walk? Well, that stretch there running down the side of it would be part of the original Torneytop Lane, where they used to, as I said, take a kind of a dogleg and then join up with what's now Torneytop Road. So this is your 5.5 acres of St. Joseph's Cemetery, and the cemetery is about 11 years old at this stage. And there's a lot of burials shown in here, mainly around the right hand side and inside the walled section. Now some people have the idea that the walled section was the original cemetery. Not really, you know, it was in the original cemetery, but it had nothing to do with the cemetery as such. It was part of an inner walled garden of the Botanical Gardens. So the wall is just being retained from the time of the Botanical Gardens. Stretch on about 60 years, and the cemetery hasn't really grown at all. The only piece that's been added onto it here is a piece of ground taking up these two plots here on the left. If you know St. Joseph's, there's a Mercury Chapel in on the left hand side. If you go in the gate, turn around to the left. That Mercury Chapel was built by the Society of African Missions. They were the owners of the cemetery at the time. What happened was Father Matthew had opened it and run it as a private concern from 1830 up until 1854, and in that year he handed it over to the Capuchin Order themselves. So they had it from 1854 up until 1879, and in 1879 they sold their interest to the Society of African Missions, or the SMA. So the SMA had it then from 1879 up until 1947, when they sold it to the City Council, or Cork Corporation as it was back then, and it's been in public hands since 1947. So the church, or the Mercury Chapel inside, kind of marks the division between the old cemetery and what they called the new cemetery, and they are completely different in layout. This is an aerial view of the cemetery, courtesy of Google Maps, and you can see here there are two completely different styles of cemetery. This is the original Father Matthew Cemetery of 1830, and these are the bits that were added on or extended later by the SMA. The original cemetery would have been kind of known as typical Victorian garden cemetery, where people use it as a place of recreation almost as much as a place for burial. You had people coming to the city, well-known people like the novelist William Makepeace Thackeray, Franz Liszt, the world famous pianist and composer, and those type of people would have come out here to St. Joseph's when it was a cemetery, but as a place of recreation. to take in and enjoy the walks and the trees and all the rest. So you can see they're totally different in design. Now, when the SNA sold the land to the corporation, all of this land here would have been part of the deal where the houses are. So had they retained the cemetery themselves, all this area would no doubt have been full of burials as well. The boundary on the western side actually was kind of formed by the plans the corporation had for building houses rather than anything to do with the boundary of the cemetery. When the corporation took it over, they had plans to build houses in Ballyfeahan, and they marked the edges then on the western side by the houses they were building. So it would be much bigger, again, if the SMA had it, is what I'm trying to say. So stepping inside, and literally inside the gate of the cemetery, you're faced by this beautiful tomb. And it's the burial place of the Murphy O'Connor family. Those of you who know Turner's Cross Parish might know there's an Archdeacon, Kerry Murphy O'Connor. And these are his ancestors. This is his family burial place. The name, I think, came about because there were two half-brothers in the 19th century. One was Patrick Murphy, the other was William O'Connor. And they were merchant tailors in Marlborough Street. They had a business in there. And Patrick Murphy died in 1837, and this is his tomb. His is the first inscription on the sarcophagus. And in fact, the reclining angel was the work of a man called John Hogan. He's arguably Ireland's greatest 19th century sculptor. He actually had this created before Patrick Murphy died. Murphy had commissioned him to make this for his grave, and it was here in Cork on display months before Murphy even died. So I don't know, did he know he was on the way out, or what was the story behind that? But it was certainly here in the summer of 1837, and Murphy didn't pass away until around the end of September. So Hogan created this, and the burial place, or it was placed on the burial place of what became the Murphy O'Connor family. William O'Connor, the other half brother in the family, lived in Mount Patrick, above kind of in the area. Do you know where the Fort Matthew Tower is? If you're coming in from Little Island, it's on the hills on your right, you can see the tower. It's similar to Blackrock Castle, that kind of small, kind of stubby tower, the tall, lean one next to it, which is the spiral staircase, basically. That's on William O'Connor's grounds. He had that built commemorating Father Matthew's temperance crusade to England in 1843. And that was his home, Mount Patrick, in Upper Glenmire. We think he's buried there as well, but there's no inscription to him on the grave. He wasn't married. He died of cholera in 1849. But there was no record of where he's buried. And the problem with the records in St. Joseph's is even though the cemetery opened in 1830, there are no records available until 1874. So over 40 years of records are missing, so, which is a great pity for people like yourselves if you're looking for family members. Unless it's after 1874, then you're kind of stumped. So this is a burial place with a sarcophagus and a reclining angel by one of Ireland's greatest 19th century sculptors. And literally on the other side of the path to it is this man's grave, Daniel Corkery. And this headstone, if anybody knows the work of Seamus Murphy, you'll spot it a mile away. That's who created this headstone over Daniel Corkery's grave. And as you can see there, he was born in 1878, died in 1964, right at the end, I think December 30th, 1964, buried on the 1st of January 65. And Corkery, of course, was highly regarded both in education circles and as a writer, novelist, playwright, and a member of the Gaelic League. So his works throughout the 20th century, he was one of the major figures in literary work here in Cork, if not Ireland, in the 20th century. Now, he was unmarried when he died, and he's buried here along with his sister, who died a couple of years later. And as I said, this iconic work by Seamus Murphy stands over his grave. So on one side of the path, you have the greatest 19th century sculptor. On the other side of the path, you have again arguably Ireland's greatest 20th century sculptor, and these two completely different and divergent monuments are side by side practically, just inside the gate on the left in St. Joseph's Cemetery. You've all heard of this man, I've no doubt, have you? Sir John Pope Hennessy. No. Good guess, but something I would have taught myself immediately. Well, I'll show you something else. But anyway, Sir John Pope Hennessy, one of the most interesting people I think buried in St. Joseph's. Born up in Wellington Road, and he went to UCC and was studying to be a doctor, went off to London to Charing Cross Hospital and promptly gave up his medicinal studies and decided he was going to be a politician instead. He was a bit of a social climber, I suppose. He saw politics as a way of getting up the ladder to the higher echelons in society. Now, he seemed to have made a name for himself. He started work in the clerk's office of the Lord President of the Privy Council in Westminster. So even though he was only a clerk, he was in a very important position. And he quickly came to the attention of a man called Lord Ross, the man with the big telescope up in Offaly, Castle, yeah. And Lord Ross persuaded the young Pope Hennessy here to stand for election in King's County, which is Offaly, yeah. And Pope Hennessy didn't need too much persuading, he said he would, and he duly won a seat in the 1865 or 1859 election, one of the two seats available at the time. And he was an unusual politician for his time, because he went into the Tory party. Well, probably nothing too unusual, but he was a Catholic. Okay, he was a Catholic Tory. They weren't ten a penny, but there was enough of them out there. But he was also a fervent nationalist. So he was a Catholic nationalist Tory, which was very unusual for his time, you know. But he preferred the Tory party. This was the way he saw, again, of getting on in life. And he started to make friends, and one of the good friends he made in the Tory party was a man called Benjamin Disraeli. You might have heard of him, one of the great leaders of 19th century British politics. Three times, I think, he was Prime Minister. To cut a long story short, Pope Hennessy lost his seat the following election, and he was under pressure financially, so Disraeli got him a job in the Colonial Office. Pope Hennessy wanted to be colonial governor, he told Disraeli, and he asked for somewhere like Queensland in Australia, which was a big promotion in terms of the Colonial Office. But he wasn't given Queensland, he was given a place called Labuan. You've all heard of Labuan. Off the eastern coast of Borneo, a small little island. No, Pope Hennessy hadn't heard of it either, so don't worry about that. But he went off as colonial governor, and for the next 22 years, he was a governor in various colonies or outposts of the British Empire. He went from Labuan to the West African settlements, the likes of Sierra Leone and Gambia. Then he went to Barbados as their governor. Then he got the Windward Islands, which is Tobago and Trinidad and Tobago and all those places. And then he got Hong Kong, which was a prime position. And finally he got Mauritius, which was again another top post in the Colonial Office. So he spent 22 years as a colonial governor, and there were two kind of common themes throughout his various governorships. One was that the colonists, or the people who were the ruining classes, wherever he went, ended up despising him. And the other was all the native people ending up loving him. So from time to time you see references to petitions got up by the colonists, sent off to London to say, would you ever please get rid of John Pope Hennessy, he's doing our head in. He was trying to make changes to make the lives of the natives better, basically. And any minor little change was of course blown up by the ruling classes, and they didn't like that. So he did send off their petition saying, would you ever get rid of Pope Hennessy? And then the natives would send off a counter petition saying, look, we don't ever want Pope Hennessy to leave here, like keep him here forever, as far as we're concerned. So he was very popular in that sense. And when he retired from the Colonial Office in 1889, as governor of Mauritius. He came back and he didn't come back to put his feet up. He had bought Rosskilling Castle. In fact, he had bought Myrtle Grove prior to that, the home of Sir Walter Raleigh, or the former home of Walter Raleigh in Youghal. Then he later bought Rosskilling Castle down in East Cork, which is sadly no longer with us. I think it was demolished in the 1940s. And so he came back to live in Rosskilling Castle, and he threw himself back into politics. And he was with the Irish Parliamentary Party, the Parnell Party at the time. There was a by-election came up in North Kilkenny, which he had been standing for as a Parnellite candidate, but the whole split in the Irish Party blew up over the scandal with Katie O'Shea, between the calling of the election and the election taking place. So Pope Hennessy stood as an anti-Parnell candidate, and he won the seat. He was the first anti-Parnell candidate to win a seat in Westminster, because it was a by-election at the time. But he said he didn't remain in Westminster too long, because that was 1890, and he passed away in 1891, the following year. And in fact, he died the day after Charles George Parnell. So his kind of funeral and his probably his life's work was more or less forgotten, because the death of Parnell obscured everything that went on in Ireland at the time. And he was, as I said, more or less forgotten about, and he was buried out here in St. Joseph's. Again, it's not far from the entrance, or going towards the wall section. Before you went, the wall section, just turn to your left, and it's just off, and the grass on your left-hand side, and the headstone is sadly broken. You can see it's in two parts. The inscription, the main part is just lying against the plinth. And his name isn't even inscribed on it, actually. All it says is, burial place of John Hennessy and family, R.I.P. You know, John Hennessy is his father. So they often did that in the older headstones. You'd see there would only be one name in it, usually the father and the family. So for a man who was so well known and well regarded in his day, he sits there in, to all intents and purposes, an unmarked grave, because his name isn't even on it. And he's forgotten here in Ireland. But the funny thing is, he wasn't forgotten in other places, because in Mauritius today, there's a huge statue of Pope Hennessy standing in one of the main boulevards, which is called Pope Hennessy Street in Mauritius. This was done by public subscription. In Hong Kong, you can walk along Hennessy Road, named after him today. It's in one of the most upmarket districts of Hong Kong. And again, the name was only chosen by the people long after his death, such as the impact he had. In Sierra Leone, they had a public holiday named after him, because he made our lives better by abolishing certain taxes. He was made a freeman at Cork in 1877. And there are about six or seven parts of the world where there are different things commemorating Pope Hennessy, but nothing really here in his native country or even his native city. So he's still remembered in other parts of the world, but not here in Cork.
That's a bit wild, isn't it? That Pope Hennessy wasn't the only Cork man who was the governor of that one and Hong Kong. Mm. There was a man from Milton who ended up
saying that he was
a fellow called Thomas O'Callaghan.
Yeah.
But he's down in Jeremiah O'Callaghan. Right.
That wouldn't surprise you. There were a lot of Cork people who were actually governors at various stages.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
So that wouldn't surprise me in the least.
Unfortunately, poor O'Callaghan ended up as governor of Portland Island.
So from a man who's fairly obscure to a man who's very highly regarded and was immediately recognisable to any Cork people today, and even nationally, I suppose, it's Father Matthew. This is his grave. Two images. This is the present day, how the grave looks, and this was taken around the turn of the 20th century. And you can see, apart from the railings and all, you can see how enclosed it is by the trees and everything that were there, you know. So it's completely open today. You've known the beautiful trees, or this was a beautiful Lebanese cedar tree, I think, that stood there for many years. And Father Matthew chose that spot to be buried himself, actually. The railings were there right up until the 70s, at least. They were just probably falling apart and they were taken down, I'd say. They were rusting away. It's a pity. I mean, it's a grave that should be maintained to some degree, really. Because he is such an important figure in terms of Irish history, not alone Cork history. The cross, incidentally, was placed there to mark the opening of the cemetery in 1830. It isn't marking Father Matthew's grave as such. It was there since 1830. Father Matthew, as we'll see in a minute, didn't pass away until 1856. But he isn't Cork by birth, but we claim him. He was born in Tipperary in 1790 to a fairly well-to-do family. And he entered the Capuchins, or Capuchines, I'm not sure what way people would say it. It's one of these things, tomato. Some say Capuchines, others say Capuchins. So he entered that order in 1813 and came to Cork the following year and settled in their little chapel on Blackamoor Lane, which is situated kind of behind, do you remember the old fire station on Sullivan's Quay? The old red brick building directly, the back of that really, was the old Capuchin chapel. And that's where Father Matthew came to administer to the people of Cork. And he quickly became a very popular priest. And by 1830, of course, post-emancipation, the Catholic chapels were coming out of these lanes. So he started working in 1832 on the building of the new Holy Trinity Church, one of the new post-emancipation churches in Cork, one of the first to be built, not the first, because it took about 18 years to build or to open Holy Trinity. Didn't open eventually until 1850. But he's best known, of course, for his work in the temperance movement. He was persuaded by a number of other people, actually, to join in with the temperance crusade, because he didn't kind of come to it lightly, he didn't make the decision lightly. There was an earlier movement in the city which hadn't been connecting with the people. So a couple of the people in that movement went around and asked Father Matthew, and he took a few weeks to make up his mind, because his bishop at the time was Bishop John Murphy, Murphy's Brewery family. He didn't want to be getting up a big temperance crusade and upsetting the Murphy family. One of his brothers was involved in a distillery, again, which this temperance crusade could have done damage to their business, you know, and indeed it did. So he took his time about making a decision. Eventually he did, and he threw himself heart and soul into it. In fact, there's a little cross, or a fairly large cross here, just outside the back wall, of a man called James Kennan, who was one of the men who persuaded Father Matthew to come aboard the temperance crusade. He was the first secretary of the Total Abstinence Society here in Cork, and the second man to sign the roll book after Father Matthew himself. So in 1838 the Temperance Crusade began, and it immediately connected with the people, and over the following decade or so it gave a better quality of life to tens and thousands, if not hundreds of thousands, of people here in Ireland, not just Cork but all over the country. And as I mentioned earlier, when he went to England in 1843, he spent a number of months there and gave the pledge again to hundreds of thousands of people. Later on again, then he went to America and spent over 2 years there between 1849 and 1851. And again gave the pledge to countless hundreds of thousands of people there. So he was highly regarded on both sides of the Atlantic. But the trip to work had a bad, very bad effect on his health. Which can be kind of viewed and judged by these two photographs that were taken. And we know exactly when they were taken. One was taken just after he arrived in America. He's 59 at this stage. And this was taken just before he came back from America, which is just over 2 years later. He's aged about 10 years, I think, in the two photographs. Piercing blue eyes he had. But as I say, his health was never right after he came back from America. He went to live with his brother for a while up in Lennemore, up in Matthew Hill, you know Matthew Hill? Yeah. Well, Matthew Hill is named because of the Matthew family. His brother Charles Matthew had a big house up there called Lennemore House. And that's why the hill is named Matthew Hill today. The house was demolished in the 1950s, I believe. But Father Matthew lived there for a while with him. Then he went off to Madeira, came back after a number of months, and eventually settled in Queenstown, as it was, Cove today, where he died on the 8th of December, 1856. And his funeral was a huge event here in Cork. Around 50,000 people, they reckon, turned out in St. Joseph's for the funeral on the day he was buried, on the 12th of December, 1856. And Again, he's very well remembered and regarded, as I mentioned. Just a few of the statues and monuments in his honour, of course, are on Father Matthew's statue on Patrick Street. This one is in O'Connell Street, Dublin. It was erected in 1890, I think, marking the centenary of Father Matthew's birth. This is the Father Matthew Tower that I mentioned previously, which is still standing today. On the hills, as I say, between kind of Dunkettle and Little Island. If you're driving in the road there, look on the hills on your right and you'll see it. And this one is actually in Philadelphia. It's part of a temperance fountain, and this is Father Matthew here. And this was a centennial fountain erected in 1876, marking the centenary of American independence, 1776. So he's, as I said, he has roads and different things named there from various, again, parts of the country and parts of the world. So, again, very highly regarded. His remains lie in the centre of St. Joseph's Cemetery today. These two are marking burials of two other members of the Matthew family in St. Joseph's. Well, at least one marks a burial, one is just a monument. This one, there's nobody buried there. It's a monument to the young 16-year-old Robert Matthew, who was the youngest member of Father Matthew's family, his youngest brother. And Robert was very close to Father Matthew and stayed with him in his house on Cove Street when Father Matthew lived there, after he came to Cork. And Father Matthew persuaded Robert to go see some of the world with his brother Charles. Charles had a trading business and he used to go away to Africa at times, trading and coming back with whatever goods he had. And Father Matthew persuaded Robert to go on one of these trips as a 16-year-old, as I said, in 1824. And Robert went off and promptly caught sunstroke and died out in Africa. He's buried in Africa, he's buried in Benin, in Africa. But Father Matthew, I've no doubt, was guilt-ridden over it because he was the one who more or less persuaded Robert to go away. And one of the first things I reckon that he did when he opened St. Joseph's Cemetery was to erect this monument to his youngest brother. But as I said, there's nobody buried there. It is simply that, a memorial to young Robert Matthew. The one on the right is actually the burial place of Charles, the man who lived in Lenna House, and other members of his family. Charles and his wife Mary Matthew were buried there. Charles died in, I think, 1871. Not sure when Mary died, but their son James Matthew, who was a judge in England, he's buried there. He died in 1908. And their daughter-in-law, he was Sir James Matthew, and their daughter-in-law, Lady Elizabeth Matthew, died in 1933. She's also buried there. There could be others of members of the family, but I don't know. In fact, this photograph, apologies for the quality, they're taken kind of from microfilm records. I haven't been able to get originals of these from the Examiner office, but this photograph appeared in the Cork Examiner in 1933, and it shows the burial of Lady Elizabeth Matthew, and there's the large Celtic cross for Charles Matthew's grave. And she's been buried there, as I said, many years after her husband. There's an interesting connection, actually, between the present-day Fine Gael party, I suppose, and this grave, because Charles Matthew and Mary, their son that I mentioned, James, and his wife Elizabeth, had a daughter called Elizabeth. She married John Dillon, John Dillon being the last leader of the Irish Parliamentary Party. He took over, of course, from John Redmond when Redmond died in March 1918, and at the following election, the end of the year, of course, the Irish Party were more or less wiped out when Sinn Féin swept the boards. And Dillon more or less disappeared into history. His father, of course, had been John Blake Dillon, one of the great Young Ireland leaders. But Elizabeth and John Dillon had a son called James Dillon. And James Dillon was founder, one of the founders of what became later the Fine Gael Party. And he was, of course, leader of Fine Gael themselves from 1959 until 1965. And he's actually in this group here, but I don't know which one he is. because you have some of the leading members of the Dillon and Matthew families were at the graveside here for this burial. She lived to the ripe old age of 94, 95, I think, so she lived a long life. And actually, she was living in the UK, but they brought her body back here to Cork to be buried alongside her husband, who had predeceased her by almost three decades. And there's a couple of interesting iron, well, I suppose the word headstone is the wrong term, but you know what I mean, iron headstones in the cemetery. There's plenty of iron crosses, by the way, you see lots of the crosses marking graves, but in terms of headstones themselves, these two, this one and this one, this is the actual, the reverse, the back side of this one, which is one of the oldest memorials actually in the cemetery, because it's marking the burial place of a man who died in April of 1813, so only a couple of months after the cemetery opened. Now the iron headstone wasn't created until 1831, so, but even at that it's still one of the very early monuments in St. Joseph's. It was created by the foundry of Thomas Addison Barnes. They were later taken over by the Perrott family, became the Hive Ironworks in Hanover Street. But at this stage it was Thomas Addison Barnes at the foundry. And it's an interesting design. There's something almost Masonic about it in a way, but I don't think it's Masonic, because if it was, it probably wouldn't have been left here in what would have been, to all intents and purposes, a Catholic cemetery. No, it was never exclusively a Catholic cemetery. It was a public cemetery where anybody, Catholic, Protestant, or dissenter, could be buried. So, but as I say, this had hints of the Masonic about it, but I think it's just all religious symbols at the end of the day. The one on the right here, the smaller headstone, there's no foundry mark on that, unfortunately, but the surname kind of gives a clue, I suppose, because it's erected by William McSweeney, S-W-I-N-E-Y, similar to the way Terence McSweeney would have spelled his name. But there was a McSweeney family had a foundry on King Street, which is today McCurtain Street, throughout most of the 19th century, and I've no doubt that this headstone was to one of their family, you know, so it would make sense, even though there's no foundry map. They're unusual, very unusual for the time to see iron headstones. And there are, again, plenty of Great War, World War I memorials in the cemetery. There's well over two dozen of the, what would you call the regular type of monument, the upright style. Very few of these kind of pedestal type memorials. These are actually known as Gallipoli markers. They were first used actually to mark the graves of those who died in the Gallipoli Peninsula. So they were used in Gallipoli for the first time, these style of markers, and they're probably more commonly used today than the upright ones, simply because if there's a headstone already on the grave and somebody wants a memorial, World War One memorial, they'll put up the pedestal type in front of the other headstone rather than another headstone, obviously. So, but these are much higher to the spot, they're only a few inches off the ground, and if the grass is anywhere high, you walk past it or fall over it, which is literally what I did with that one, which is how I saw it. I gave it a kick as I was going through the long grass. And I found three in total in St. Joseph's of that style, but there may be more. I don't know. But they're interesting. I hadn't seen them before about 2 years ago. But that's what I'm told is what they are. Gallipoli markers. And there's one here, American style war memorial in St. Joseph's. Again, it's just inside the wall section on the left-hand side. And it's the burial place of this man here, who's shown in the photograph, a man called Patrick Bowen Murphy, Patrick B. Murphy, who was, as it says here, he was a chaplain, so he was a priest in the US Army. He was born out in Ovens, we think, in County Cork. Right. Could be, I'm not sure he's out that direction, or I certainly am. But his family immigrated to America when he was about five, so in the early 1850s. He was born in 1849 himself. But they settled in Boston, and he actually joined the Fenian Brotherhood as a 19-year-old, but left them afterwards, and he went into the priesthood, and he was parish priest in a number of different parishes in the Boston area. But when the Spanish-American War broke out, which is what this marker is for, the SPAM War, as you can see, he was chaplain to the 9th Massachusetts Infantry Spanish-American War. When that broke out in 1898, it was a kind of a short-lived campaign. And what was happening there was a number of countries basically trying to get independence from Spanish rule. Cuba, Guam, Puerto Rico, the Philippines, places like that. America came in on their side, fought with the Spanish. After a number of months, the Spanish basically bailed out, but America kind of stayed. And then they had to kind of struggle to get the Americans out. Now, the Americans did leave for the most part, but they didn't leave any of these places completely. And they still have all these bases in the same little countries today, like the Philippines and Guam, and of course, the most notorious of all of them is Guantanamo Bay, which is right down the southern tip of Cuba. And so these are all kind of legacies from the Spanish-American War. But Father Murphy was coming home to Cork. He used to make frequent visits back across the Atlantic, and on one particular trip on the SS Cedric, a liner coming back, we think he suffered a heart attack and he died on board the ship on the 1st of May, I think, 1929, and was buried about a week later here in St. Joseph's. He wanted always, he said, to be buried in the grave of his family here in St. Joseph's. So that's where he was laid, that's where he's laid ever since this memorial was put up sometime afterwards. I don't know when, because a few months after his death, some veterans of the Spanish-American War came to Cork and put a bronze memorial on the tomb. But this is obviously not the bronze memorial, so this was put up again sometime later. He's an interesting connection with Dermot Lynch, actually. Dermot Lynch, the Irish volunteer, IRB man, who was reputed to be the last man to leave the GPO in Dublin in 1916. They're connected through their cousins, I think, through their family. And this photograph, again, it's not a great photograph, but it shows Father Murphy being buried on the day in 1929. I'll try not to gargle here. This is a British military funeral, as you can see. Literally just inside the gates of the cemetery, it's after coming in and turning left. What's behind him here is the Murphy O'Connor tomb. So they've literally just come in the gate and turned to the left, taking the first path. And this was a funeral that took place in December 1914. So just shortly after the outbreak of the First World War. Now, this man was a member of the Dublin, Royal Dublin Fusiliers, stationed up in Collins, well, wasn't Collins Barracks back then, but you know, he was up in the barracks at the time, and he didn't die in battle, and he actually fell down a flight of stairs in the barracks and fractured his skull and died a couple of days later. And was buried out here with full military honours out in St. Joseph's Cemetery. The interesting thing about it is I can't find a record of his burial, even though we know the exact date he died, we know the exact date he was buried. His photograph, the photograph appeared in the Examiner. We know that date, we know everything, but he's just not registered, which is very unusual. I wanted to try and find his grave, but I couldn't find it, unfortunately. And this is, I suppose, this is a Free State funeral, an Irish military funeral. This is the gun apparently firing a volley of shots over the grave of a man called Corporal James Bright. And again, Bright died under tragic circumstances. He was stationed again up in the barracks, but they were on rifle practice out in Kilmore Camp in 1935. And during one of the sessions, he received a bullet wound to the thigh from a Vickers machine gun. And he ended up in hospital for a few days out in Mallow. But blood poisoning set in and he died again within a few days or about a week or so after he was shot. So again, he was buried up in St. Joseph's in around the end of May, I think it was the 29th of May, 1935, with full military honours, but this not being the English version, this being the Irish version of the funeral. This man, again, an unusual burial for the time. He died in the circumstances of what he was at the time. He's a man called, as you can see, Michael Deering, a Limerick man by birth, who spent a lot of his time here in Cork. Worked in a number of breweries. He worked in Arnott's Brewery, which was on today's Sherman Crawford Street. Do you know the College of Art and Design facing St. Mary's in the High School? Well, Arnott's Brewery would have been there, got the same building that Crawford College replaced the brewery in the early 20th century. But Deering would have worked for Arnott's. Arnott's being the same Arnott of Dublin, by the way, Arnott's department store. So John Arnott was buried out in Douglas, St. Luke's, you know, the Church of Ireland. Church, he's buried literally kind of in front of the door of the church. There's a big, you know, it's Douglas Park. Anybody, if you're ever in the park, just look over the wall, you can't miss it. Inside the wall of the grounds of the church, there's a massive big obelisk tomb. That's the Arnott burial place in Douglas. And he would have been a mayor of Cork, even though he was a Scotsman by birth. But getting back to Deering, he worked for Arnott's Brewery, and later he worked for Murphy's Brewery, because Murphy's took over Arnott's Brewery after a while. But he's best known for his involvement with the GAA, this is Northern Ireland Middle here. And he was one of the founding members of the Cork County Board. He was there right at the beginnings of the GAA itself. He was, for most of the 1890s, he was president of the Cork County Board. That was the term that was used at the time, which Frank Murphy loved that, the El Presidente of the Cork County Board, rather than secretary. But that's what it was at the time, and he was that for most of the 1890s. And in 1898, he was recognised nationally because he became president of the GAA itself in 1898. And he held the office for 3 years. But he died in 1901 at his home at Quaker Road. Now, when he died, he was still president of the GAA. And he's, in fact, the only GAA president to die in office. No other president before or since has died while holding the position. We've lost a couple of presidents in the last couple of years. Ex-presidents, of course, with Jack Boothman from Wicklow, isn't it? And Joe McDonough from Galway, a couple of those died recent years. But as I said, Deering was the only man who died while he was still the president of the GAA, and it was the GAA themselves who erected this memorial the year after his death. And it's full of symbols, as you can see, with the GAA logo, the old style GAA logo, the old Hurley and Slitter. These are crossed pikes surrounded by shamrocks, and the crossed pikes signify that he was a member of the Cork Young Ireland Society in the 98 committee. They were commemorating the 1798 rebellion, the centenary in 1898, and he was one of the main figures in that. One of their main tasks, of course, was to have the National Monument built on the Grand Parade, which did eventually get built, but it was a few years after Deering's death. And down at the end of the inscription it says, "Against his God, save Ireland," that very nationalist term that was used a lot on headstones and indeed in various courts in Ireland and the UK. There are two mass graves in the cemetery. Top left here being the older of the two, and this is the place where all the famine victims were buried. Not just famine victims, because prior to the famine, you had many victims of cholera and other diseases would be buried in this mass grave, which was basically poor ground for people who couldn't afford their own plots. But during the height of famine, they reckoned that between September of 1846 and the end of May of 1847, about a 9-month period, there was a meeting of the health committee held just in early June of 1847, and it was said that something like 13,000 people went into that plot in that 9 month period. 13,000 people just in that 9 months alone. Now I should add that the plot is much smaller than it originally was. A lot of the vaws, I believe, because I found a reference to one happening, had been cut into the poor road, the old poor road, because it had closed at that stage in 1847, and these vaws, or many of them, were created from the 1860s or so onwards. And what's ironic about it is these are the vaws of the wealthiest people of Cork, and they're buried in what's ostensibly the poor road. You know, so even though they have these magnificent monuments over their graves, magnificent tombs and vaults. The other one here on the top right is the later poor ground that was became so when the SMA took it over after 1879, because it sits outside the boundary what would have been the old cemetery prior to that. And to add more to there, you know, I suppose they have this lovely little memorial here to the family victims who died during that period, but they have it placed up here, not down here, which is, I don't know why, but that's where they put it. And again, the reason the ground looks higher here than the rest of the cemetery, because when Father Matthew closed it in 1847, he had it topped off with like hundreds of cartloads of earth and about of lime and 4 feet of earth. So it became a big mound, you know, so that's why the ground there is actually higher than the rest of the ground around it. I mentioned Terence McSweeney there a while ago. Left hand side there is the burial place of members of his family. This is the McSweeney family grave. His mother, father, sisters and brothers are all remembered on this monument here, this headstone. His father, even though his name is on it, is buried up in Melbourne, not here in Cork or even Ireland, he's in Australia. But you have the likes of Maura McSweeney or Mary McSweeney, Annie, both of them who founded, of course, Scolita, up in Wellington Road in the McSweeney family home. They're both buried here. Annie would probably be one of the most kind of staunchest of all the Republicans in the family, even more so than Terence herself. Himself, I'd say, but she felt that she was carrying on his legacy after his death. This one here on the right, it's an identical cross to the McSweeney one, apart of course from the inscription. But it's a burial grave of a man who was known as Shandoon. His name was Timothy Murphy or Tighe or Marcou, and he was a great Gaelic scholar, member of the Gaelic League, and he wrote for a number of Gaelic publications. He translated Daniel Defoe into Irish. So he was well known in Gaelic circles, and he was a great friend actually of Terence McSweeney. Of course, McSweeney himself is buried up in the Republican plot in St. Finbarr's Cemetery, but the rest of the family are here. But himself and Tighe Murphy or Shandoon, as you know, were very close. And Shandoon died in April 1919, and this memorial was put up in April 1920, and this is a photograph taken on the day that the memorial or the cross, the Celtic cross to Shandoon, which is here on the right, extreme right, was erected a year after his death. Again, apologies for the quality of the photo, but it was unveiled by Terence McSweeney, which is this man here. And that was Terence McSweeney's first official duty as Lord Mayor of Cork, was to unveil this monument out in St. Joseph's. Remember, he had taken over from Tomás McCurtain, who had been killed. Why is that running on? I mean, the club then. Is that turned on, by the way? It's not turned on. Right, thank you. So McSweeney, as I say, unveiled a cross just a week or 10 days after he became Lord Mayor of Cork, and as I said, it was the first official duty he carried out as Cork Lord Mayor. It's an interesting photograph. I think these two guys are bodyguards because they're not taking any heed of what's going on behind. Because he would have been under threat at the time and he would have had bodyguards, we do know that. So these two guys, it might be just the way the photograph was taken and just caught up as they were turning, I don't know. But they do look a bit like they're kind of just scanning the horizon to see if there's, make sure nothing comes to do him any harm. This is a story to a young man who died on the SS Titanic, or this Titanic, man called William Henry Lyons. And as it says on the headstone, we lost his life on the SS, and should be R on this Titanic, April 14, 1912, age 26. He was actually a naval seaman. He was working on board a ship, and his family were living in Market Lane, just off Patrick Street. You know, the vineyard public was in there. I think that was the Lyons family business at the time, because the father was a public in there. And he went off to sea and he worked for the White Star Line and he got a plum job on the Titanic, and so he taught. And of course we know what happened afterwards, the Titanic struck an iceberg. Over 1,500 died. Lyons initially actually survived. The sinking was pulled aboard one of the lifeboats, but we suspect he was suffering from hypothermia and he died not long after he was brought aboard the Carpathia, when the Carpathia picked up the survivors. He was buried at sea, so he isn't actually buried here, but the family put up this memorial, this headstone with his name inscribed on it, and telling us how he died in 1912. This Dominican plot is the largest of the communal plots, I suppose you'd call them, in the century. The burial place for members of the Dominican order, and one of the men buried there is Bishop Thomas O'Callaghan. He's the only Bishop of Cork to be buried in St. Joseph's. Since it opened, I think we've had seven, including the present Bishop John Buckley. Six have died, but the other five are buried elsewhere. He's the only one out in St. Joseph's, Bishop O'Callaghan. He was Bishop of Cork from 1886. Up until 1916, so he was in that kind of period, I suppose from the end of the land wars to the outbreak of hostilities in the 1916 rising, you know? So it was that period where, I suppose, constitutional politics was really to the fore in Ireland. So he died in June 1916, and this is a photograph of his funeral passing through Patrick Street on the day he was heading out to St. Joseph's. And this photograph was taken again on the day out in St. Joseph's Cemetery. There's the large sculpture that sits on the Dominican plot. It's the work of John Francis Davis, the sculptor who gave us the figures on the National Monument on the Grand Parade. There was a huge crowd, as you can see, that day in June of 1916. And again, you can see all the trees. Well, the trees are around even at that stage, you know, there was still a lot of kind of remnants of the botanical gardens, I suppose, at the time. Just a few more slides. I want you to guess who that is. Well known Cork character.
James, James, then.
No, it's a girl, she. Yeah.
John Singer,
is she? Caddy Barry, when she was about two, I'd say. This was a photograph given to me by a member of the family, actually. That's her mother, Mary Hurley. And Caddy Barry is a difficult woman to track down in terms of the census. In terms of her birth record, because she wasn't Cathy, she wasn't Catherine, she was Mary. She was Mary Catherine, or Mary Kate, as she was known. Mary is her mother, Mary Hurley, or Mary Barry, as she was when she married, and Kate Hurley was her grandmother. So she was called basically after her grandmother and her mother, but Mary Catherine. So it took me ages to find her in the records, because I had her date of birth, but every time I looked for Catherine or Kathleen or Kate, there was nothing coming back. And eventually somebody said, try Mary. So I phoned up through Mary. But anyway, Cathy Barry, here she is, standing outside her home in corporation buildings in later years. And she, you know the story of Cathy Barry, she had her little eating house, in inverted commas, on Dalton's Avenue, just off the Cork. She was born on the Cork. And for many years she ran her famous or infamous establishment. But all types of people used to come in there, from students right up to lawyers and solicitors and judges, and she'd be up before the court and she'd recognise a judge or a solicitor and she'd be talking. I'm sorry, do you have a night? No, do you have a good night? I'm late. No, I'm just kidding. She'd be winding him up, like, you know. But she lived her later years in corporation buildings, not in the kind of the square kind of pair, but on the ones fronting onto Paul's Avenue, is it? The side of the car park, facing the side of the car park, basically. She was living in number 6, I think, there. And she died in the Mercy Hospital in, as you can see, 27th of December 1982. Buried up in St. Joseph's. Very few people have seen the attendant of her funeral, which is remarkable considering how well known and how well kind of regarded she was as a character here in Cork. She's standing there in her shawl and her bag. Anybody want to guess what's in the bag? Not money, not two beans. A favourite delicacy, get them at the seaside. Not even get them at the seaside. Periwinkles. She used to love periwinkles, seemingly. So she just saw a bag of periwinkles inside the bag, ready. So. This man, our young boy as he was then, very striking features. Grew up to be one of the great Cork actors.
Mulhare.
Eddie Mulhare. So he was born here. He was born on Quaker Road in 1923. Family moved to Tonyville up off High Street when he was an infant. So he spent most of his life, early life in Tonyville, living, and he went into acting after he left college here in UCC, and from small beginnings he reached the top really in terms of Hollywood in the UK, because he had a career that spanned the 40s, 50s, 60s, 70s, 80s, 6 decades, 90s. He was working right up to his death really in 1997. He was in the Ghost, and he's probably best known for those two series, really, The Ghost and Mrs. Burr in the 60s, and the young fellow like me would remember him, Knight Rider in the 1980s, The Hoff. So he was Devin Myers, and actually that's a publicity shot from Knight Rider, actually. He does, remember the famous car kit? He's leaning on him there, so. But as I say, he's, in terms of longevity and in terms of the quality, he's easily one of Cork's greatest actors of any era, because he had this stage and screen, TV. He was nearly every TV series you would imagine, and the two best known is the ones that were mentioned, of course. But he was working right up to 1996 in a film with Walter Matthau and Jack Lemmon, and that only came out in 1997, shortly after Mulhare's death. He died in California, and his body was cremated, actually, but his brother had gone over and brought the ashes back to be buried here in the family grave in St. Joseph. So his name is inscribed right down the end, but it doesn't have the blacking, so it's just, you know, so it's below John. Just make up something there like that. So his name is inscribed right down in January. May was it 1997, I think he died, but he's buried here, so we have a well-known actor. And this shocking photo is an interesting one, actually. It is, this is Mulhare's mother on the right. Anybody recognize this man? Might be that easy to spot now, to be honest with you, but he was a well-known TV personality in the States. Ed Sullivan. The Ed Sullivan Show was one of the biggest I suppose, entertainment shows in the 40s and 50s in America. Well, here it got to the States. Originally in 56, but in 57, he took over from Rex Harrison in the Broadway show My Fair Lady. And he kind of made his name through that. But in 1959, Ed Sullivan came over to Cork and went up to Tonyville, just off High Street with his film crew, and interviewed Ed Mulvaney's mother to be featured in a special St. Patrick's edition, St. Patrick's Day edition of the Ed Sullivan Show in 1959. So amazing to think that in the 1950s you had this big kind of television personality coming over, ending up in a little house, a little cottagey house up in Tonyville. So, but it did happen. We photographs to prove it. He went around various parts of Cork, did some filming, but one of the places he went to was Tonyville here off High Street. And I'll leave you with this one, which is the last one. This man is here somewhere. I'm lying, he's not here somewhere. His name is all over the place now. Paddy Whiskey, you know, you mentioned Hennessy a while ago. Paddy O'Flaherty. The man who gave his name to the whiskey. Paddy O'Flaherty, again, he was born in Cork in 1850. Didn't start working for the Cork Distillery Company until he was about 32. Yeah, he started working in 1882, but he worked with them for almost 40 years afterwards. Didn't retire until he was 21. And he was a salesman, a commercial traveller as they were known at the time. And his kind of area that he covered was stretching from Yall out to Mallow, all that area between that. But how he used to operate was he'd get in touch. Let's say he was visiting Yall in 2 or 3 days time. He'd get in touch with a few of the people in Yall. Look, tell the people, I'm coming down to Yall, I'm going to free samples of the whiskey to give out. It was great. He made it very popular, of course, like, and everybody was coming out for the free samples and that, and they were delighted with Paddy. The company weren't delighted with Paddy, of course, because he was giving away a load of free whiskey, which they didn't like. Now, but eventually, they began to realise that he was selling a lot more than what he was giving away as samples, so it was actually working, you know. And over time then the people are ringing up, let's say you're a Republican and you wanted a case, or in the case of Clancy's, there were 20 cases of their whiskey. So they'd ring up and they say, look, could I have a case or two of Paddy's whiskey or Paddy O'Flaherty's whiskey? And that was going on and on and on. And eventually the penny dropped with the company and they decided, right, we'll make a deal with Paddy and we'll trademark the whiskey, we'll call it after him. So they changed the name of the whiskey, and the whiskey at the time had a nice kind of sharp little sweet name called the Cork Distillery Company Map of Ireland Old Irish Whiskey. So it wasn't exactly tripping off the tongue, as they say, you know. So rather than that, they had a Paddy Flaherty brand from around 1914. They agreed, they struck a deal with Paddy to trademark the name as the Paddy Flaherty brand. Now Paddy died. He retired in 1921, and one of the main agreements to have Paddy was he'd be kept on his full salary for the rest of his life, basically. So after he retired, he was retained on his full salary. That was part of the deal. So he died about 7 years later. He died in 1928. He was living down by the SMA, down in Blackrock Road, down next to that. But when he died, his widow, it was his second wife, actually, she was a lot younger than him, asked that they remove the name Flaherty from it and just call it Paddy, so that's how it became then, simply Paddy Whiskey. Now, still today, you'll have Paddy Flaherty at the end of some of the bottles. They've dropped the O, you see. The O, they got him out of it, they weren't using his actual name, so they call it Paddy Flaherty at the end. But it's been known as Paddy ever since, from well over 100 years now at this stage. And it's all named after the famous whiskey salesman. And it's probably the most ironic burial you'll find in any cemetery, because St. Joseph's was opened by the Temperance man. So you have the great Temperance Crusader here, and 20 yards away with the great, one of the greatest whiskey salesmen in Ireland. So it just goes to show, like, when you're in the graveyard, everybody is treated the same. So on that thought, I'll leave you.